Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Australia's most unbelievable true stories, written and read by Jim Haynes. The dedication reads, to Gillian. Introduction. I've wanted for some time to make a collection of all the odd stories I've stumbled across in almost 30 years of documenting Australiana on radio, or while researching other more specific collections on topics as diverse as railways, horse racing, trucking, drinking, Aussie yarns, maritime history, etc. I always seemed to find a few stories that were too weird to be true, and they didn't always fit into the collection that I was compiling at the time. Over the years, I put many of these stories aside for a possible collection of unbelievable stories. This is that collection. Rather than make the whole collection a miscellany of believe-it-or-not anecdotes, and for the sake of having some order, I divided the stories into four sections. Looking through the stories I'd earmarked for the collection, I found that three obvious sections presented themselves: royal visits, war, and aviation. The rest of the stories are in section one. Australia's obsession with British royalty is odd enough in itself, but the first four visits to Australia by members of the royal family were full of such unusual events that accounts of those visits seem to me decidedly slapstick and verge towards the odd and even hilarious at times. I suppose we expect wartime to produce tales of unbelievable courage, cruelty, and coincidence, but the Battle of the Coral Sea was truly farcical. Were it not for the loss of life involved, it might even be considered comical. My favourite story in the war section, however, is the strange tale of Private John Leake. The early days of aviation were full of amazing, swashbuckling true adventures, but the story of the Flying Band Tassel Sisters Australian tour is hard to beat. Although three of the sections do have a common theme, the style of the stories varies considerably. Some of the events narrated in the collection are weird in the sense of spooky. The case of the totally inexplicable phenomenon known as the Guyra Ghost is my favourite of those. Some of the stories document the lives of characters whose turbulent, multifaceted biographies defy human logic and limitations, characters whose adventures, tragedies, and amazing feats rival those of the fictional Baron Munchausen. I cannot decide between Tom Wills and Jorgen Jorgensen as my favourites in that category. Then there are the ridiculously coincidental historic events that, when told, make people exclaim, "That's unbelievable." Let me give you an example. In 1875 and 1876, the Victorian government held a royal commission into the colony's defences and invited Lieutenant General Sir William Jervois, Director of Works and Fortifications in London, to come to Victoria and advise the government on how best to defend Melbourne. Sir William is best remembered for later being Governor of South Australia and Governor-General of New Zealand. He also had the most impressive and largest set of mutton chop whiskers I have ever seen, and believe me, I have looked at thousands of photos and paintings of colonial sideburns. Sir William and his offsider, Colonel Scratchley, advised that the best plan was to fortify the entrance to Port Phillip Bay, and consequently fortifications and barracks were built on Point Nepean in 1878. Gun batteries were installed in 1886, and the fort, Fort Nepean, housed a company of the Royal Victoria Volunteer Artillery Regiment. Skip forward to the 5th of August, 1914. The German merchant ship, SS Faltz, was attempting to leave Port Melbourne when Victorian Defence Chief, Lieutenant Colonel Sandford, gave an order to the fire commander at Fort Nepean, one Lieutenant Morris. The order was, "Stop her or sink her." The Faltz ignored signals to halt, and the B1 gun of the Fort Nepean battery, barrel number 1489, fired across her bow. The Faltz then returned to port and the crew was arrested. Skip forward again to 1:30 a.m. on the 4th of September 1939. A vessel leaving Melbourne failed to identify itself, and the A1 gun of the battery, barrel number 1317, fired across her bow. The ship then identified herself as the local freighter, SS Waniora. In 80 years of being manned and ready, these were the only two times that any of the Port Phillip guns were fired in action of any kind. Why does this matter? Well, those two shots were the first shots fired in World War I and World War II respectively. The first was fired within minutes of war being declared in 1914 and is indisputably the first shot of World War I. The second shot, fired within hours of the announcement that Australia was at war in 1939, has strong claims as the first official shot of World War II, though this has been disputed, but it was certainly the first shot fired after the declaration of war was made by Britain and Australia. All coastal installations were gradually removed after World War II and Fort Nepean became part of Point Nepean National Park in 1988. In the early 1960s, someone suddenly realised the guns that fired the first shots in both World Wars were gone. Luckily, they were tracked down, one in a scrapyard at Brooklyn in Victoria and the other at an artillery range at Port Wakefield in South Australia. Today, the gun barrels are back at Point Nepean. You can picnic beside barrel 1489, which fired the first shot of World War I, or barrel 1317, which did the honours in World War II. If you, like me, find it fascinating, weirdly coincidental, and slightly bizarre that a virtually useless colonial port battery at the bottom of the world on the south coast of Australia fired the first shots in both World Wars, both of which originated 12,000 miles away in Europe, then maybe this is the book for you. Part 1. Stranger Than Fiction. This first section of the collection contains stories that range from the truly weird and inexplicable to some that I would label typically farcically Australian. When the 19th century novelist Joseph Furphy was asked, in light of the fact that all Australians were British subjects at the time, and remained so until 1947, how he thought about himself and his writing, he replied that he was offensively Australian. I think that phrase is an apt one for several of the stories in this section of the book. The story of the Charters Towers riot is a case in point. The failure of European settlers to understand the continent they had invaded is the source of quite a few stories covering events and consequences that leave me shaking my head in disbelief. Here's an example. In spite of being advised by the indigenous population that the Flinders Ranges were not always as green and fertile as early pioneers found them, white settlers established wheat farms in a period of good seasons, which soon became abandoned ghost settlements when the normal seasons returned. Abandoned and ruined farmhouses are now a picturesque feature of the area. Early white settlers at Gundagai were advised by the local Aborigines not to build on the south side of the Murrumbidgee River. The advice was ignored, and when a flood wiped out the settlement in 1856 and drowned 89 people, a third of the white population, the Aborigines used their canoes to rescue the survivors, who finally took the advice and shifted the town to the other side of the river. Most Australians are aware of the infestation of prickly pear that wiped out millions of acres of grazing land in New South Wales and Queensland. But how many Aussies know who brought the pest to Australia? It was the man credited with founding the British settlement, good old Captain Arthur Phillip himself. Phillip loaded up with the noxious cactus in South America as the first fleet headed southward with its cargo of human flotsam. Why? Well, the cochineal beetle lives on the prickly pear. You can see it in white fungus-like colonies on the cactus pads. When squashed, the tiny beetles turn bright red and provide brilliant scarlet cochineal dye, which was used to make the famous British military redcoats red. Philip thought a handy supply of red dye would be a great thing, and he needed the cactus to feed the beetles. The prickly pear story has quite a few amazing twists and turns. Scientists persevered with importing various cactus-eating bugs until the hilariously named Cactoblastus moth was imported, survived and flourished and wiped out the entire infestation. This tiny moth made millionaires out of many speculative farmers and graziers who bought the cactus-infested land for virtually nothing. After billions of little Cactoblastus caterpillars ate the millions of acres of cactus, those lucky land speculators were left with prime grazing land, most of which is still farmed by their descendants to this day. In the tiny town of Boonaga, near Dalby, the beneficiaries of the destruction of the prickly pear at least had the good grace to pay tribute to their tiny saviours. While the vast majority of memorial halls in rural Australia are dedicated to those who served in two world wars, the memorial hall in Boonaga is dedicated to the memory of the little grub that ate the cactus. The hall is called the Cactoblastus Memorial Hall. As the little Cactoblastus ate nothing but prickly pear, it didn't prove to be a pest afterwards either, like the notorious cane toad, which didn't actually eat the sugarcane pests it was imported to eat. Cactoblastus did its job and then died away with the cactus. The cane toad, we soon discovered, ate everything but the pests it was imported to control. One unfortunate victim of the prickly pear invasion was the poor old emu. In spite of the fact that there was a lot of evidence to prove that the prickly pear was pretty good at spreading itself rather quickly, the emu copped the blame for spreading the seeds of the cactus by eating them, running a distance, and pooping them out. So a bounty was placed on emus and the poor old gangly birds were shot in their thousands. You rarely see an emu in that part of Australia now. Another place where our national bird emblem should be scarce these days is in the Campion district of Western Australia. The story behind that is a ripper. There have only been two times in our history when the army was called out to wage war on home soil, here on the Australian continent. Once was when the militia were roused to arms in Broken Hill to counter an act of war against our nation that was perpetrated by an ice cream vendor and a butcher. That story appears in another section of this collection. The other time was in 1932, in the Campion district of Western Australia, about 300 kilometres northeast of Perth. The invading army was estimated to be around 20,000 strong. What made it worse was that the area threatened was an area of soldier settlements, farmed by veterans of World War I. The Western Australian government asked for protection from the Commonwealth, and Defence Minister Sir George Pearce decided to order a full-scale military operation. Soldiers from the 7th Heavy Battery Royal Australian Artillery were armed with Lewis machine guns and 10,000 rounds of ammunition, and they set out for the battlefield. The enemy? Emus. That's right, emus. It seems huge flocks of emus were devastating the farmland, and some soldier settlers had already quit and left their little bit of the district to the birds. The first great battle of the emu war lasted 9 days, and guess what? The emus won. In those 9 days, the army blasted away at 20,000 emus and managed to kill a few dozen. The military mastermind who led the campaign, one Major Meredith, reported that the emus were almost impossible to defeat. Not only did they ignore the normal conventions of warfare and terms of engagement by zigzagging erratically at high speed, they were also almost impossible to kill. Bullets didn't stop them, even if they were hit. If we had a military division with the bullet-carrying capacity of these birds, said a frustrated Major Meredith. It would face any army in the world. The Major was fulsome in his praise of the enemy. They can face machine guns with the invulnerability of tanks, he reported. One of his soldiers, a hardened veteran of the 9-day emu war, gave the Argus newspaper the benefit of his battlefield experiences. There's only one way to kill an emu. Shoot him through the back of the head when his mouth is closed, or through the front of his mouth when his mouth is open. That's how hard it is. The army decided to retreat, much to the dismay of the settlers. On the 10th of November 1932, the Argus reported that settlers were alarmed at the Defence Department's decision to recall the machine gun party, which, after overcoming preliminary difficulties, had begun to make an impression on the ravaging hordes. The army persevered for another month, and eventually Major Meredith claimed his men killed 986 emus with 9,860 rounds of ammunition. 20 years later, the emus were still winning. So the Western Australian government decided to build an emu-proof fence. It was more than 200 kilometres long, 1.3 metres high, cost £52,000, and joined on to the famous rabbit-proof fence. Did it work? Well, as late as 1994, the Western Australian government was still carrying out emu eradication programs. A few ghosts and some colonial corruption. It comes as no surprise to me that the largest number of good old-fashioned ghost stories in Australia, particularly those from the colonial era, seem to emanate from Tasmania when you consider the fact that the European history of the island was so gruesome, horrific and embarrassing that the name Van Diemen's Land was scrapped in 1856 and the new name Tasmania has been used ever since. It was hoped that doing away with the old name would help people forget that during the first half century of European settlement, the island was best known as a place of unbridled savagery, cannibalism, lawless bands of brutal bushrangers who did as they pleased, and the official planned extermination of the original indigenous inhabitants. I recall being pleasantly surprised during my first visit to the island to find that every hotel I stayed at had at least one resident ghost, usually a convict in the cellar. Sydney, although it has a much larger population and a slightly older colonial history, has comparatively few resident ghosts and haunted buildings. There is, however, a girl in a white dress who appears near Middle Creek Bridge on the Wakehurst Parkway. If you're alone and stop to give her a lift, the results could be fatal. If a motorist even just sees her and acknowledges her presence, she's been known to take control of their car and take them on a very scary ride indeed. I've never encountered her personally, but when I mentioned the legend on radio, several listeners called in to assure me that they knew someone who had once talked to someone who had encountered the spectral girl. Fisher's Ghost. Sydney's most famous ghost story begins with a bloke arriving at a pub in desperate need of a drink. It was 4 months after the mysterious disappearance of a local farmer, Fred Fisher, in 1826 that John Farley, a respected and honest local farmer, arrived at a pub on the rural outskirts of Sydney in the area that is now the bustling outer suburb of Campbelltown in a state of shock. In one version of the story, Farley claimed that he had seen the ghost of Fred Fisher sitting on the railing of a bridge over a creek. The ghost pointed to a paddock down the creek, then faded away. The body of Fred Fisher was later discovered in the paddock where the ghost had pointed. The other version says Farley reported seeing a ghostly figure sitting on the bridge railing. Investigations showed blood on the bridge at the spot where Farley saw the spectre, and an Aboriginal tracker was brought in and said he smelled white man fat under the bridge. Fisher's body was found in a deep hole in the creek near the bridge. Frederick George James Fisher was born in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.